Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the study of antiquity and the Middle Ages. As always, I'm your host, Nick Barksdale, and today we are joined by a very special guest, Dr. Miano. Dr. Miano, thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Hey, thanks for having me. Appreciate being here.
Dr. Miano is actually the creator and founder and host of an awesome YouTube channel called World of Antiquity. I can't recommend it enough. And before we begin our series, I want to go ahead and encourage you, check out the links in the video description below, subscribe to his channel, click the notification button, and definitely share as much as you can. It's an awesome channel. He's an awesome guy, and I cannot recommend his videos enough. And now, for many of us who have watched an occasional episode on ancient aliens or ancient astronauts, or if you've read some ancient literature, you're going to be familiar with this term, and that is the Anunnaki. And so, Dr. Miano, my question is, who are they? What are they? Why were they written about? And why are there so many conspiracy theories about them today?
A lot of the ancient astronaut theories goes back to Zechariah Sitchin, as you may know. But I can tell you what I know about the background of the word and who the ancients believed the Anunnaki were. And there's not a simple answer for this, but the original term was not Anunnaki. It was Anunna. It's a Sumerian name, Anunna. Anunnaki is an Akkadian name. I told you they live near each other, right? But Anunna, the Sumerian word, is the original word. And the word means something like seed of a ruler or of royal seed, something like that. And the first appearance of the word, I think, comes from a building hymn of King Gudea of Lagash. He lived in the 22nd century BCE. They're referred to there as gods, having some kind of divine judicial function, and they're prayed to for protection. In other places, they're said to decree fate. But indications are that originally they were just part of a local pantheon of gods. But over time, as empires formed in Mesopotamia, they take on the role of an imperial pantheon. The Akkadian version of the word, Anunnaku is actually, I think, the nominative form, but Anunnaki is just kind of what we've been calling them. But anyway, the Akkadian version doesn't appear until the old Babylonian period. That's a couple hundred years after Gudea, between 2000 and 1600 BCE. And they only appear, the Anunnaki, in literary texts. They don't appear in administrative documents, say, having to do with temples or sacrificial rituals or anything like that. Even though they're gods, there doesn't seem to have been an Anunnaki cult, in other words, what I'm saying. No temples exist that are dedicated to them. Even in the literary text, they don't play a prominent role. I think there are one or two myths that highlight them. They're said to reside, in present tense, in the city of Nippur. At that same time, there's another term that's sometimes applied to them, Igigu, or as we usually say, Igigi. We don't even know the meaning of that word, but they're described as great gods, so like the best of the gods or something like that. In that period, the old Babylonian period, the Anunnaki and the Igigi seem to be the same group. But the Anunnaki are never displayed as a group in any art of Mesopotamia. You can't point to anything and say, oh, there's the Anunnaki. Sometimes a number is given for them, but the number is not consistent. Sometimes there's seven of them, eight of them, nine of them, 10 of them, 50 of them. In one poem, they're said to number both 300 and 600. Go figure, right? In the law code of Hammurabi, the number I think that's given for them is 10. And at the end of the law code, they seem to be listed, the gods' names. Among them would be Anu, Enlil, Ea, Ninlil, Shamash, Adad, Sin. It's all I can remember off the top of my head. But so there, you know, specific gods are mentioned. These are all like some of the major gods. Sometimes the Anunnaki are spoken of as a specific group of gods, and sometimes they're talked about as if they're all the gods. In one poem, They're spoken of as being the offspring of the god Anu, who was already thought to be the father of all the gods. But then, later, after the Babylonian period, around 1300 BCE forward, especially in the Assyrian text, the Anunnaki and the Igigi are spoken of as different groups. The Igigi being the high gods, and the Anunnaki being the gods of the underworld. But that's not true across the board. The gods who are assumed to be part of these groups changes over time. As new gods are worshipped, the number goes up. So it's just very inconsistent. It's kind of complicated. But the short answer is, there's nothing in the text that say anything than that they're just gods, right? Zechariah Sitchin said, oh, they may be people from another world or something like that. This is actually common in the ancient aliens, area of thinking, and that is that the gods in the myths are real. Not really gods, but that they're based on real individuals, okay? That they're just aliens from another planet or something like that. It's, it's kind of an attractive idea, but there's no reason to suggest that just because a community has gods, that they're basing them on actual real persons, right? So anyway, I hope that kind of answers the question.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us here today at the Study of Antiquity and the Middle Ages on our series where Dr. Miano guides us through a variety of interesting, obscure, and often controversial subjects, and he sets the record straight. Dr. Miano, thank you so much for coming on today.
Hey, it was my pleasure. Anytime.
Check out the links in the video description below. It's going to take you to a variety of sources from his academia page to his YouTube channel, and really just enjoy it and take advantage of all the awesome insights that he has to offer us to help us better understand the subjects that we both love.